Today, I'm going to talk about chair-side procedures which we are always following during the biopsy. Coming to the introduction, what is biopsy? The removal of tissue from living organism for the purpose of microscopic examination and diagnosis. The term biopsy is derived from a Greek language, that is, a bio means life and opsia means to see. The term biopsy was first introduced by Ernest Besnier in 1879. When a lesion is observed, several important orderly steps should be undertaken to identify and characterize it. For example, you have to take first the health history of the patient, then clinical examination, followed by radiographic and laboratory examinations. With that guidance, we have to do the surgical procedure to obtain or obscure that specimen from the patient. So what are all the indications to do biopsy? Any lesion that persists more than 2 weeks with no apparent cause, any inflammatory lesion that does not respond or subside even after 10 to 15 days of local treatment after removal of the local irritant, persistent hyperkeratotic changes in surface tissue, any persistent tumescence either visible or palpable beneath the relatively normal tissue, lesion that interfere with local functions such as eating, breathing and all that, then bony lesion not specifically identified by clinical and radiographic examinations. So coming to the limitations, when the general condition of the patient is very poor, we are not supposed to take any biopsies. When acute, virulent or pyogenic infection is present, that time also the biopsy is contraindicated. No need to do biopsies of normal structures, nor is it necessary to biopsy of inflammatory or infectious lesions that respond to specific local treatments as in pericoronitis, gingivitis and periodontal abscesses. There is no need to do biopsy of irritative or traumatic lesions that respond to the removal of perceived local irritant. So the classification of biopsy, it is based on the techniques used, materials used and the clinical timings. According to the techniques what we are using, there are 5 methods: incisional, excisional, aspiration, exfoliative cytology and stab roll method. Now coming to that incisional biopsy. Incisional biopsy means it involves removal of representative portion of a target lesion and of a part of healthy tissue. So if the area under investigation is difficult to excise because of its extensive size more than 1 cm in diameter, that time you can use this incision technique. So the principle of this technique is the incision with your scalpel should be in a wedge fashion shape or shape. The lesion extends into normal tissue at the base or margin of the lesion, then only you can compare and see whether where the pathological lesion is starting, whether it is an epithelium or it went till the connective tissue. So the necrotic sloughs should be avoided anyway. There is no use in taking any necrotic sloughs, and sufficient amount of tissue should be obtained to give a conclusive diagnosis. So the next is excisional biopsy. Excision means a removal of entire lesion and in depth with a safety margin. So the indication is if the lesion is less than 1 cm and that too, those lesions clinically it should appear as a benign. Then only you have to do the excision biopsy. So the principle is the entire lesion along with 2 to 3 mm of normal appearing surrounding tissue, as I mentioned in the picture, you have to excise them. Any lesion that can be removed completely without mutilating the patient is best treated with excisional biopsy. So the aspiration biopsy is nothing but fine needle aspiration is a diagnostic procedure used to investigate lumps or masses. In this technique, a thin needle, that is 23 to 25 gauge needle, a hollow needle is inserted into the mass for sampling of cells to take after being stained will be examined under the microscope. The sampling and biopsy considered together are called fine needle aspiration biopsy or fine needle aspiration cytology. The types which is under that, it is determined the content of the lesion and used to remove cellular materials for diagnostic examination by pathologist. And the aspirated content, wherever you are, whatever you are aspirating with that also, you can come into a diagnosis. For example, if the cystic content is having a straw color fluid, you can think of any cystic lesions. And if it having pus, you can think of abscess. And if it is nothing is having that means that aspiration is negative, only air if it is there, you can think of traumatic bone cyst, or if it is containing blood, you can think of any vascular malformations of jaw. So the inability to aspirate the content indicates the mass is solid. So any radiolucency in bone of jaws should be aspirated before surgical intervention to rule out any vascular lesions that could result in life-threatening hemorrhage. If this fails, small periosteal flap be elevated and burr is used to introduce the needle towards that mass if it is in case of intrusion. So this is the methodology. Here I mentioned that what you are feeling, any lump or something like that, you have to feel with your index finger and your thumb finger. Then you have to put the needle over the mass and you have to aspirate. Then you have to take it in a slide, which like normally how we are making a smear, and stain it and see under microscope for a diagnostic criteria. So the fourth one is exfoliative cytology. Microscopic examination of shedded cells from body surface or cells harvested by rubbing or brushing a lesion tissue surface. So based on the method of cellular collection, one is scraping, one is with using the brush biopsy. While scraping, the lesion is scraped using a cement spatula, but in brush biopsy, oral brush, there's a special instrument is the oral brush that is used to place that oral brush over the lesion, and 5 to 10 times you do a proper scraping, you can free all the shedded cells from the three layers. So the fixation in scraping you have to do, and in oral brush biopsy that much fixation we don't need, but we can see in a computer screen in a very well-defined manner. So some lesions like leukoplakia and lichen planus also, you can use this both kind of exfoliative cytology techniques. And the fifth one is stab and roll biopsy. This is a very important step in cases of desquamative gingivitis. Whenever the epithelium connective tissue interface is not proper, there if you put your scalpel over it, the epithelium will just cut off from the connective tissue, and while seeing in the biopsy, you can't understand whether, you can see only the connective tissue, then you can't understand whether any vesicloblast lesions are there. If the vesicle is there, the epithelium connective tissue interface will be less, and those times you can't see any epithelium, then you can't give any conclusive diagnosis. In those cases, you can use this kind of stab and roll biopsy. It is nothing but first you have to take the scalpel with 15 size, and first you give a prick over the surface of a lesion till it reaches the bone. Then you give one rotation like I mentioned in that picture, and just take the whole lesion for a biopsy. So according to the material, conventional scalpel, punch biopsies are there. It is very simple, safe and inexpensive technique. And however, the drawback is being it is unable to remove large lesions and is limited to epithelial and superficial mesenchymal target tissues. And especially B forceps is there. It is a forceps which we can isolate the lesion from other areas. We can take the biopsy in a bloodless field. And the third one is electrocartery, and lasers we are using to just lasers. If you are using, we can cartridge the blood vessel, and those time when you are cutting the tissue, you can reduce the bleeding while taking the biopsy. So, but a CO2 laser, that carbon dioxide laser, the electrocartery lasers have the advantage of producing completely bloodless field, but can induce thermal artifacts. Hence, it is best to excise the tissue with a scalpel and use electrosurgery to control hemorrhage. So these are all the pictures. First is the scalpel image where I'm showing this. This is a scalpel, then this is a punch biopsy. And this is the thing what I mentioned, the B forceps. One forceps, the forceps of that one side will be like this, and the other side will have a forceps, and you can cut the tissue and take. And the fourth one is a laser. So the commonly occurring artifacts will happen when you are doing biopsy. If you are not maintaining the steps properly, then once you are taking the biopsy specimen, you have to fix it as soon as possible. So the infiltration of local anesthetic solution in the place of the biopsy where you are going to take, that also will cause some ballooning effect in the cells that will mimic some of other pathology, rather than if it is a normal tissue also, because of the local infiltrations of LA, it will cause the ballooning degeneration that will misguide you towards some other diagnosis which is having a normal architecture. So the crushing of tissue, while if it is a papilloma or something like that, or it's very merged with the surface epithelium, those times to take out the lesion from that, the dentist will take a forceps or pathologist will take a forceps and just crush that. Because of crushing also, you can see some of the cellular architectures that will get destroyed. And the electrocartery will take. Yes, we can take in a bloodless field, but electrocauteries will form a deeper staining things that will show, that will mask the malignant cells if it is there in the margin. So the margin of the lesion in case of CA, you have to see positive margins. That means you should not see any kind of malignant cells towards the margins. But when you are doing with electrocautery, that will get more stain, and if it is there some malignant cells, that stain will mask the malignant cells. That is one in, that is one artifact in electrocautery. And inadequate fixation also results in tissue degeneration. And sometimes some foreign materials, like while in OT, some suture threads or something like that, some calculus, restorative materials also will come inside the biopsy, and that also will misguide you. And taking insufficient amount of tissue also, you can't tell the prognosis, you can't tell the diagnosis. So the correct interpretation of a biopsy is dependent on quality of specimen, and the shrinkage occurs during fixation and processing, thereby reducing the tissue size. So whenever you are taking biopsy, make sure that you are taking an adequate amount of tissue. And in conclusion, the concern of patient's welfare, correct diagnosis is of extreme importance. When considering biopsy, a little forward planning and thoughts can greatly improve the diagnostic value obtained. So inadequate of it at any stage could result in an inconclusive biopsy and may necessitate the patient undergoing a repeat procedure, which ensures physical and psychological stress for the patient. Thank you. I hope you can understand this.